Hi everyone. Welcome to my Facebook Live. I'm Anna Raimondi. I wanted to begin tonight with a prayer for all those in California where the wildfires have been raging for the last couple of days, and in Mendocino County where the fires are destroying many of the wineries, which of course is putting people out of business, displacing people, and 15 people have died. So let's pray together that the fires, God walks among us, and the fires are put out quickly, and the raging stop, and the people who have been affected will recoup, recover, and be able to go on with their lives in abundance. And once again, we pray for the United States and for all the disasters that have been striking us recently. We pray for the land on which we walk. We pray for each other and for peace, both within the planet, the earth, and within the brotherhood and sisterhood of humanity. Okay. So tonight I thought that I would discuss what is church. And I would like to start by reading a quote from my book, which you will be able to get next week. And if you ordered it online, it should be sent to you next week. So the quote is, or the answer is to a question that I asked Mary. So I asked, you have said that the world is a church. Can you expand on that? And Mary answers, churches, temples, and other houses of worship are structures within the world. They were erected as the place where people believe that God resides and people can come to worship him. And it's true, God does exist in these structures. And as people pray in unity in these places, his vibration becomes stronger and stronger. Yet it must be known that God doesn't exist solely within these houses of worship. Look around you at all times and know that the earth is a church and its people, clergy. Go outside into nature and see the magnificence of God in the plants and animals. Feel God's healing in the sun's brilliant rays and in the beams of light from the moon. God created the world to be a sacred place, and so it is. Honor the earth and stop all the destruction of the holy ground on which you walk. Give homage to the trees and lie in the grass and let heaven surround you. Many churches are filled with gold and jewels to show that God's house is a kingdom of richness. This is not necessary. The richness of God is in nature and all that he created. It is so simple and so right. Give honor where honor is due. Go to your house of worship and pray in community with others. But know that sacred ground and the house of God is all around you as you live your life in the world that love created. She often interchanges God with love because God is the highest vibration and a vibration of love. So she brings this through to us, you know, as I'm trying to pinpoint her, you know, and trying to get her in a corner about where should we worship? Which church should we worship in? And what she pretty much says, if you want to worship in a church with community, that's wonderful. But you don't have to. You can go outside and worship. And you could still go into your community, into your structures. But it's nature. That's the church. She says at some point in the book also that we are all prophets. That the prophets just don't exist in history. That we are prophets. We are the ones that can change this world. We are the one that can set it in motion. Let's start with looking outside our window and saying, this is magnificent. No one but God could have created this. I'll never forget, a long time ago when my oldest son was 5, we went to Wyoming, and we went to the Grand Tetons. And it was August, and yet there was snow on top, and it was a very cool morning, and we were outside, and I looked up, and I literally felt the tears come to my eyes, because there was no way that anyone could deny that the magnificence, the beauty in front of me was created by someone, something, an energy greater than us in all glory. This is a gift to us. It's a gift. It's a free gift. And how much of us are not using it or destroying it? And in a lot of ways, the earth is rebelling. The earth has a vibration and it's rebelling. It doesn't want to be destroyed. It wants to be worshipped and loved and adored because it's an extension of the Creator. The very ground we walk in, the mechanisms of how plants grow and die, and the cycles of the season that mirror the cycles of our lives. Think about that. It's all so perfect. And what do we do about it? We pollute. We pollute our air, we pollute our water. We destroy, we take down trees when trees don't need to be taken down. We don't honor. It's important to honor. It's important to sit back and honor. And so this is our church. Outside this room, right out there, is my church. A place where I can feel God. I often do sit outside at night, and I just feel the vibration and the presence. And I suggest you do the same. You will feel it. It's not just me. I'm not a chosen one. We're all chosen. It's about doing it. It's about saying, I have some time to devote to something that's so much greater than I am, than we are. To feel the supreme, to know that the kingdom is outside. Not only is it in here and over there, but it's outside. It's the glory. And you might even hear some angels sing. Who knows? Okay. I can open this up for questions if there's any. Let me just start from the beginning. Okay, let me go down here. Hello to everybody who's saying hello to me. Let's see. I'm still going. So Tony says, she feels God under the stars. You know, it was always pointed up that heaven was there because it's so beautiful. And yet, you know where heaven is? Right here. It's just another dimension. We look up the stars and we see all this beauty and we think, that's where they all must be, in the twinkling stars. Because it's beautiful. Because it's made by the hand of the greatest painter, the greatest artist. The one that created us. I don't know, can it get better than that? You know, I like to travel, and I've seen a lot of things. And what always amazes me is that no matter where we go, there's something that's just unbelievably gorgeous that maybe I didn't see somewhere else. But maybe I did, and maybe my eyes weren't opened. Open your eyes. It'll bring great joy into your life. It stirs your soul. Your soul is connected and it understands. You might feel something leap within you. I like that. I'm sure you would too. I don't understand, Tammy. You're asking, how do you learn to use it? I don't know what you want to use. So Carrie says, I totally know what you're saying, Anna. I've had those feelings all week, being in the mountains. Have felt so close to God and the angels. The mountains, nature, have been my church this week. It's beautiful. And the things that you can get brought, the special moments, the sacredness of it, the beauty of it, really. You know, last week we talked about raising vibration. This raises your vibration. Keep it simple. Mary repeats over and over again in conversations with Mary to keep it simple. I don't know why, as human beings, we always want to complicate everything. We always want to make it more difficult. It doesn't have to be that way. Keep it simple, really simple. You don't need to overthink nature. It's not work. It's not a job. And if it is a job, God bless you. Because that's a great job, to be in nature all the time. Just enjoy it. Completely enjoy it. Okay, I'm not seeing any questions. You know, I'd like to know where you find your sacred place. Where's your church? Outside of, you know, your religions, where's your church? Where do you find that peace? Where do you find God? No, it doesn't have to be in nature. It could be in, you know, your car, if that's where you talk to God. I mean, I talk wherever I am, you know. Especially nowadays in cars. People have Bluetooth coming through. So who knows who's talking to their friend on the phone, or who's actually talking to God or someone in heaven or praying. Mary repeats over and over and over again our need for prayer. And what does prayer mean? It's just communication. I mean, think of it as a parent. Don't you want your kids to communicate with you? Don't you want to feel needed and wanted? This is the perfect way for us to get closer to heaven, is to communicate. Communicate directly to God, or ask Mary to join you in prayer. Prayer can just be a conversation. If you want to say the prayers from your religion, that works, if that's what makes you comfortable. Or you can just talk. And you don't have to use these and thous, because that's not how you talk. Talk just how you talk, with all of your accents. God must get a real kick out of this accent I don't think I have. So, let's see. Okay, so Lily Riches was just going to say car. You know, as long as you're not meditating in the car, that's okay. I don't meditate in your car, okay? But you can talk in your car. It works, you know? Talk as you're cooking dinner. But you know, it's really important to be silent, because that's where the answers come through. So if you can find a place in addition to all those places, because you can talk whatever you want. But if you can find a place that's silent, because really God comes through in the silence. It's those thoughts that you get in your head, or the feeling in your body. But it has to come when your mind is calm and not over processing. So that's what meditation's kind of for. So you can hear what God needs to say to you. Okay. Ooh. Okay, so Blythe says, I'm in Indiana with my mom while she gets ready to pass, noticing the small things for the first time in a long time. I finally got to enjoy the changing colors of fall, and it's like I'm seeing the beauty of nature for the first time, noticing the small things for once. Well, I'm sorry that your mother is passing, and I know that you must be in pain having to witness this, but I think it's wonderful that you're looking at a changing season. As she transitions, you're watching a transitioning season, and that's beautiful. You know, sometimes it takes pain to help us to wake up. You know, so Blythe is sitting there in Indiana and her mother's passing, and she's noticing the beauty around her. She was made to stop and look. Stop and look. Awaken. You know, God is in the small things, not just the big things. The little daisies that grow. I was in Montauk this past weekend, and I was amazed to see, I don't know what they're called, ocean daisies, sea daisies, the daisies. You know, in the middle of October, you know, looking at these like bushes of daisies, and they were beautiful, absolutely beautiful, just growing, you know, at a time when I never see that, I never notice that. And bees were buzzing, not that I like bees because I really am afraid of them, but the bees were flying around them, but I had pants on, so I wasn't afraid. You know, it was like spring in the middle of October. It's pretty amazing. And it's nature. You know, man didn't do this. This is out of the control of anybody except God. That's where it is, which is why we need to honor this. You know, not make, you know, the bees extinct because the bees are having a hard time, the honeybees. Butterflies are becoming extinct. We're doing this. And, you know, you may say, but I'm not doing this. Okay, well, I don't think I'm personally doing this. But collectively, this is humanity. We are part of the whole. And it begins with us saying, I'm not going to do this. And you know, if I see someone doing it, I'm going to say, that's really not a good thing. I'm not judging anyone, but I don't think that's a good thing to do. You know, not get angry, but speak up. Because this is what we have. This is what we have. And with all these disasters going on, the natural disasters, leaving aside the hate crimes, we need to really pay attention to where there is beauty. Where we can capitalize on the beauty, shut off the TV and see the beauty and feel the love from it. I don't know, when I'm outside, I just feel this like opening up of me, especially at night when I could smell, like now you smell the sweet smell of fall. You know, sometimes you smell, you know, somebody burning something outside or a bonfire or something like that. And it's such a nice smell and it brings up memories. Because we are a part of our memories. Those don't go away. That little girl still lives inside of me. And the children still live inside of you. It's who we are. Our memories of seasons past. Our memories of walking up a mountain or by a stream and feeling just that wonderful joy. That joy is God. Nature is God. It's all love. And it's absolutely wonderful. Okay, let's see. Okay, so this is a little bit off topic, but Marie is asking, any suggestions to help others to be more positive and closer to being spiritual without pushing? Be you. Show them how you live your life. They'll wonder why. They'll wonder why are you so happy? Why are you at peace? What do you have that I don't? You can't push somebody into it. You know, I tell people all the time, you know, sometimes they're not on the same page with their spouse. You know, that doesn't mean their spouse isn't spiritual. You know, there's many paths that get you to the same castle. You can't push people to think the way you think. Or believe the way you believe. You know, you have to just be a walking model of it. That's really it. You know, you can speak your truth. You can say what you need to say. But you can't shove it down someone's throat. And you don't know what they've been through. And you also don't know what their relation is with God. Any relation is a good relationship with God. So don't try to convert people. I never try to convert people. You know, I just try to lead people to understand that there's something so much greater than us. Call it he, call it she, it has no gender anyway. Call it God, Allah, the power that is, the universe, it doesn't matter. Just recognize that God is the great I am. The great I am. And what does the great I am mean? It means it's consistent. Think about that. You can say, I am hungry at 12 o'clock in the afternoon. And Mary's talks about this in the book as well. And at 12:02, you can say, I'm satisfied. I ate a banana. So there's no consistency in our I am. But when God says, I am, I'm not saying I am this or I am that. I just am. I am. It's consistent. It's always the same. You know, there's something so comforting in that. There's no change. There's nothing. Nothing that's going to be different at 12 o'clock and 12:02. It's the same vibration, the same energy, and the same love. And that love doesn't go away. And that love really wants us to come and join with that love and bring peace to the world. Whether it's going out in nature with people and saying this is great, or whether it's talking to your friends and maybe answering their questions about what you believe, or just being nice and compassionate. How would that be if we were all compassionate to each other? If you went into a store and people said, I'm so happy that you're here. I love to see you walk down the produce aisle. Do you know what that would do to us? Or instead of watching the news and hearing all this horrific stuff, but maybe see something great, because there are great things in the world and people doing great things. Wouldn't that be wonderful? It can be. It really can be. I believe it. Mary has told me it can be. It can be. Start small and simple. Okay. This little button. Okay. Okay, so somebody is talking about a mother who is resentful after the death of her father, and how she, this anger, is overflowing to her children and alienating her children. All you can do is pray for her. You're not responsible for your mother, okay? She's responsible for her. You can say to her and point out to her that I want you to see what you're doing and hopefully have her recognize it and want to change. But each person is responsible for themselves. I'm responsible for me. My children are responsible for themselves. My husband is responsible. My mother is responsible for herself. Now, granted, I like to have a say with my children because they're my babies, even though they're 20 and 27. But in the end, I can't rule them. I can't rule my mother and I can't rule my husband. We're responsible. Yeah, anger and resentment are horrible. And they don't destroy the person that they're aimed at. They destroy us. It's against our soul to feel that way. It's against the nature of God and love. You know, it's about forgiving, maybe not forgetting, because it's hard, really hard to forget, but to forgive and to say, I don't know why this happened, but you know what? Life goes on. Life goes on. And maybe I didn't get the stuff I wanted. Or maybe I didn't get the love I wanted from a parent. So instead, I'm going to learn from that. I'm going to love my kids like no one will ever love their kids. It's about changing it up and stopping cycles. Because the cycles exist in families. And they perpetuate. And perpetuate. Stop the cycles. So you, Stacy, you don't carry the resentment. You don't carry the anger. Okay? If you can talk to your mother and she wants to change, so be it. If not, this is a lesson. This is a lesson for you to learn. And it's a good lesson for you to learn because you can pass it on to your children. And they can see you as that mother that you wanted. So it's a little bit about letting go, too. It's difficult. Okay, so a lot of talks about my book. yes, my book will come out on the 17th. And, you know, what I read from you tonight was one little quote. You know, there's lots and lots in the book. Again, the book, you know, I didn't, if any of you know anything about people who write books, okay, especially first-time authors, you know, the gain is to get my book into everybody's hands so that they have the tools, the real hardcore tools, to find that peace within. Mary's bringing us the tools to bring not only peace for the world, not only global peace, but inside ourselves, how to love ourselves. How do you love anybody else if you don't recognize and love yourself and honor yourself? She's bringing that loud and clear to all people, okay? Again, this is to all people. This is not just people in the United States. This is people here, people in Timbuktu. This is not for, just for Christians. This is for Jews and Muslims and whoever else is out there. It's for everyone. And I find this so amazing, so amazing. I'm so blessed to be able to be her conduit, because I did not write this book. She wrote the book. I mean, there's parts of it that when I reread it, I said, oh my God, like, I have to read that again because I don't really understand what she's saying here. And then it's like a light bulb goes off. You know, keep it simple, keep it simple, keep it simple, and pray. Because it can get better. There is something called enlightenment. There is something called bliss. It exists, really exists, as surely as you and I exist. How can we think that this life is it? That we live for 80 years, 90 years on this planet that goes like this, and then it's over. How could anyone think that? That this is it? That we're so one-dimensional? We are multidimensional. Multidimensional, so capable of so much. Capable of people who did remote viewing, who could see things from the United States in Southeast Asia. They were trained to see things, and they did. Our minds, our hearts, our souls. It's so exciting. It's so exciting to recognize this. It's so exciting to learn. And it's so exciting to read and to realize that we are not doomed. We are not doomed. There's things that we can do to save ourselves, save this planet, save the world as we know it. And maybe someday this will be our heaven. It doesn't have to be a dream. It can be a reality. Okay, I see a question. Okay. I understand the connection to nature as well. I too have been in the mountains of Utah for the past week and have been in such awe with all the beauty of nature around me. This has made me so much more aware of my connection with God's spirit. How can I further explore my own sense of spirituality? I've never felt that I have found my own sense of spirituality before. Everybody's spirituality is unique. There are many ways that we have to be brought there. You know, you can be brought into your spirituality with religion. You can be brought into your spirituality with nature. You can be brought into your spirituality by meditation. You can be brought into your spirituality by being with spiritual people that you're attracted to on an energy level who will raise your spirituality. It's a journey. It's a journey within. It's finding what makes sense to you. So if God to you is spirit, the great spirit, connect to the great spirit, you know, whatever that means to you. And if that means, you know, meditating at, you know, in a lit temple, meditate in a lit temple. If that means reading books to help you go deeper and to help you understand, then do that. Again, there's a lot of ways to get to the castle. There's not one path. There's many paths. And it's up to you to find it. What I always tell people is expose yourself. So if something comes through your email, you know, someone's doing a class in shamanism, which is Native American meditation, and or not just Native American, the indigenous people, and you think, sounds interesting, and it's easy to get to. You can go there. Then go. Learn that, you know, nobody is saying that you can't have things and money and all of that. But when money becomes your God, and it becomes the focal point of your conversations with people, and the focal point of your thoughts, something's wrong. Something's wrong. I drive a nice car. I like nice things. I live in a nice house. I like to travel. That takes money. I like all of that. But it's not what I'm thinking about all the time. As a matter of fact, I don't really think about it, okay? What I'm thinking about is, you know, things that are more important, that are more wholesome, that are more spirit generated. You know, I'm just not throwing things on Facebook that I don't believe. You know, I'm putting things out there because I think it could help people heal. It could help people find that place. I'm not perfect by any means, you know, but my spirituality belongs to me, and to me that's perfect. And your spirituality should belong to you, and that's perfect, without judging anybody else's spirituality. And how can you tell if a spirituality is good and right? It's centered on love. It's centered on something deeper. It's bigger than us. You'll know because you'll feel it. You know, and if you can't get into nature, you know, when it gets really cold here, you know, I mean, my idea of nature is just sitting in on my deck. You know, I don't go hiking. I like to look at the ocean. You know, that's my idea of getting in touch with nature, sitting under the stars. That's my idea. Yes, I live in a very countrified place. There's state land behind me filled with woods, you know, so there's animals there. You know, I'm amazed by it. You know, I sit at this table and I see animals running across my deck. It's wild. Well, it's beautiful. But yet my spirituality, again, can exist, you know, sitting in my car at a red light, you know, and feeling something tingle inside of me. You know, there's something called the Kundalini experience. I don't know if any of you are aware of that or what it is, okay? It's an awakening. And it's said to begin at the base of the spine, and it curls all the way up, and it changes people. It brings them deeper. It opens them up, okay? Yet, when I remember being 14, 15 years old, living on Long Island where we had stoops, and I was sitting on my stoop, and I was all by myself, and it was a very clear night, and the stars were very bright, and I felt this overwhelming feeling of love, like overwhelming, and I was a kid, overwhelming, and I started to cry. I couldn't even process it. I couldn't handle it. That was an awakening for me. That was something that said, wow, there's something great. And not only is it out there somewhere, it's here and it's touching me. And it was such a blessing, such a beautiful blessing that to this day I can't forget. That was my Kundalini experience. And you know, and it was the beginning of me going deeper and then going, making a right turn and then having to come back. You know, because I'm a human being. But once God got me, that's it. I'm here, you know, and then everything started opening up. And again, I'm not perfect. You know, we all make mistakes in our lives, you know. I try to be kind to all people, and sometimes I'm not. You know, I have a temper. It was difficult to believe, but I have a temper. I try not to show it that often. I'm getting better. I'm calmer. The more meditation I do, the calmer I am. You know, the more I'm able to not really focus on stuff that, you know, it's not that important. So, you know, whether it's the mountains, you know, or anywhere else, let the world awaken you. Let it deepen your spirituality. And as I said, there's many, many, many ways. I like books. music. Music also opens up your soul. Certain movies, you know, not the garbage that we see on television, that I don't know if you can hear it in the background that my husband's watching. But there's, you know, there's so much out there for us to capitalize on. Okay, let's see. A few more seconds, unless there aren't any questions. I am looking forward to all of you reading my book. What I'd like to do, if you have a book group, and if you want, I can be Skyped into your book group. I'll ask questions, kind of like I'm doing now. It's easy. All you have to do is tell me, and I'll put you on the calendar, and no matter where you live, we can Skype. I don't know how to do the big Skypes, so you'll have to be in the same room, I guess, unless somebody wants to teach me that. And I would love to discuss the book, and there's no charge for that. I want everybody to read this book. I want everybody to learn and hear her words and feel the love that's coming through. And it's not so much what I want, it's what she wants. It's what Mary wants. She wants to help us heal. She wants to get us back to the creatures we were at the beginning of creation, to our purity. So again, you know, when the book comes out, which is on the 17th, that's next week, I can't believe it's next week, feel free, you know, message me or whatever you call it, what happens when I guess, PM me on you know, this page, and you know, we'll set up times once your group reads the book for them to ask me questions and for me to talk about it. You know, it's just, I just can't wait to share her with you. Okay, somebody's asking a question, let's see. Okay. So, I think that's it for tonight. I thank you all for joining me. I hope and I pray that you will have a peaceful week. And somebody wants me to lead a prayer before we close. Okay. So, close your eyes, and I want you just to go into your heart, to feel your heart, to kind of feel the beating of your heart. And as you breathe in and out, I'd like you to feel your heart expanding. And we ask that the angels surround us and protect us and lead us and guide us, that our spirit guides stand before us, helping us with the decisions in this lifetime, that we allow Marian as the mother, the comforter, as she wraps her mantle around us, clearing our minds, as she too opens our hearts so that we may receive the great love and give it back to the world. Amen. Thank you all. I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful week. God bless.